We're going to talk about two cases of women with breast cancer, and we're going to talk about how they would have been treated years ago, and we're going to talk about how they would be treated now. And the now is largely a result of research that has been done, some at Dana-Farber, some to a large extent at other institutions and in other groups as well. So why don't we get going? So I'm doing this sort of in medical style. This is how we might present a case in a conference. So Amy D. is a 44-year-old lawyer who presents with a lump in her breast. A core biopsy demonstrates that it's cancer, and she has a lumpectomy and a sentinel biopsy. This is 2006. The lumpectomy reveals a 1.9 centimeter estrogen and progesterone receptor positive cancer, which means that it is sensitive to female reproductive hormones, so we can use anti-hormonal therapy to treat it. It's moderately differentiated. This in layman's terms, describes how angry the cancer looks under the microscope, so this is in a middle grade. And importantly, it is HER2-3+. So this is a HER2-positive cancer. HER2-positive cancers have too many copies of the HER2 gene, which make an excessive amount of HER2 protein on the surface of the cancer cell. This is something that is good for the cancer and bad for the patient. And we have been very successful over the years developing drugs for HER2-positive breast cancer. And in 2006, this was soon after results were released from several large trials looking at patients who were typically at a little higher risk than this patient. But she, based on those results, she received a 6-month course of chemotherapy with trastuzumab. Trastuzumab is Herceptin. Following by a full year of Herceptin, this is chemotherapy that is fairly toxic chemotherapy and is associated with some small long-term risk of both heart dysfunction and a small risk, an increased risk of leukemia. And she also receives radiation and is started on endocrine therapy. So that was 2006. We're going to talk about 2015, but before we do, I'm actually going to ask Terry to comment on what her surgical management was then and what it would have been in, let's say, 1995.
So what Dr. Weiner is referring to is that from 1995 to 2005, let's say, we saw a real shift with the way we evaluate the lymph nodes under the arm, the axillary lymph nodes. So if a breast cancer is going to spread from the breast, typically it goes to the lymph nodes first, and we use that information to determine someone's stage, has the breast cancer spread to the lymph nodes, and we also have always felt very strongly that if it had spread to lymph nodes, that we didn't want to leave it behind. So when I started my training in the mid-90s, the standard approach was axillary lymph node dissection. The only way that we could check the lymph nodes under the arm was to remove them all to see if there was cancer there or not. And although that's a very nice operation to do as a surgeon, it's not very nice for the women sitting in the audience because it puts them at significant risk of lymphedema or swelling of the arm. And so in the late 90s, a technique was developed called sentinel lymph node mapping and biopsy, where we learned that we could inject a tracer into the breast, and that tracer would travel in the lymphatics, just like a cell would travel, and it would stop in the first set of nodes that drain the breast, so the guards or the gatekeepers for all the nodes that you have under your arm. And those nodes became known as the sentinel lymph nodes. And so over several years and thousands of women who underwent a sentinel node biopsy with an axillary dissection, it was demonstrated that that first set of nodes accurately reflected the status of the rest of the lymph nodes under the arm. And so by 2001, we'd really stopped doing axillary node dissections. We were doing sentinel lymph node mapping, only removing those first two or three lymph nodes to send to the pathologist to see if there was cancer in them or not. If there was not cancer, then there was no further lymph node surgery performed, and we were able to spare about 80% of women that what we would call a morbid procedure, the axillary node dissection. There was no sense in taking out normal lymph nodes. And so rates of lymphedema, swelling of the arm, with sentinel node biopsy hover around 5%, which is a significant improvement over the 20% that we used to see with axillary node dissection. So this is clearly an example of less is more. We demonstrated that we still needed to remove the lymph nodes in women who had cancer there, but we didn't need to remove all of them to determine if there was cancer there.
So, thank you. So, Craig, back in 2006, she received a somewhat long course of chemotherapy. How might she be treated today? And how would that differ?
Yeah, so today it's likely that we would eliminate the 6 months of chemotherapy and replace it with 3 months of a single agent chemotherapy drug along with Herceptin. So in 2006, this woman would have received 4 cycles of adriamycin and cytoxan chemotherapy, followed by 3 months of Taxol in conjunction with Herceptin, and then the Herceptin would be continued for a year. That carried with it significant side effects from the adriamycin and cytoxan. It increased the risk for congestive heart failure and prolonged the duration of her treatment. Today, she would likely receive 12 weekly doses of Taxol chemotherapy along with the Herceptin, with a total of 1 year of Herceptin. So her treatment would be 3 months less of chemotherapy and significantly less toxic with outstanding outcomes. So this is based on a study that the Dana-Farber actually conducted as the initiators of this trial, although it was a multi-center trial, performed by Sarah Tulaney, a member of our group, along with others, in which these women who had, this is a stage one breast cancer, received the 12 weekly doses of Taxol and a year of Herceptin. In a trial of more than 400 women, there were 2 women who developed metastatic disease with 4 years of follow-up. And these cancers, when they recur, tend to recur earlier. One of those women who developed metastatic disease actually didn't have HER2-positive cancer. If you look at the data, I think 4 of these women actually developed a local recurrence of their disease, which a local recurrence is still potentially curable disease. So this woman would have about a 98 to 99% chance of remaining disease-free 4 years later with significantly less toxicity and can actually probably speak about the difference that that would make in terms of her life going forward.
Anne?
Sure. So this is less is more, and this is where we've kind of followed the pediatricians. So for years, we've seen success rates in terms of curing more kids with cancer. And for years, the pediatricians have said, wait, what are we doing to these kids? Now they're being cured, but they're moving on and having all of these problems as they enter the rest of their lives. And as we've gotten better, particularly in diseases like HER2-positive breast cancer, we've said, okay, we're getting much better at targeting that HER2 protein, at getting many, many more women not to hear from breast cancer again. What are we doing to these women in terms of the rest of their lives, and can we start to peel back in lower risk situations and get them the good parts and spare them the more toxic, not so good parts? And this is a perfect example of that. And what we're sparing them is that very increased risk of heart damage. There is a small risk of heart damage with the Herceptin alone or the trastuzumab, but much lower than when you give it in partnership with an anthracycline, even when it's given sequentially or one after the other. And the other huge thing is that that conventional chemotherapy is also exposing women to a very small but very serious risk of secondary leukemia. And that's something obviously that you want to avoid. And finally, the quality of life aspects of this. We all know that a diagnosis of breast cancer is a really hard thing to undergo, both from a medical and an emotional standpoint, and to have to go through 3 more months of toxic chemotherapy, which is really good when you need it in terms of getting people more towards a cure. But if we can spare people that, it's fabulous. So this has been a real home run in terms of how we care for women who present with this problem.
Good. All right. Any more comments about this case? We're going to move on to the next one, I think, which is...
I guess the one other comment would be if you took this back to 1995, we would have been able to tell this woman that her prognosis was poor because she had HER2-positive disease and that there was little that we could do about that. That we could give
other
her the
chemotherapy.
We would give her the chemotherapy, but that these HER2-positive cancers tend to be more resistant to chemotherapy, tend to metastasize earlier, tend to be worse actors. So this is a situation in which maybe more was more, in that we had the addition of Herceptin, and then 10 years later, less became more, or 15 years later, less became more as we were able to peel off that chemotherapy.
Yeah, I mean, we are all hoping that over the years ahead that we will find other areas in breast cancer where we can be as successful as we have been in HER2-positive breast cancer. That said, we still need to do more here. There are still women who unfortunately lose their lives from HER2-positive breast cancer. And while we're focusing on backing off on treatment for some women for whom that's possible, there are other women where we still very much need, not necessarily to add on treatment, but to identify new and better treatments. So it's a matter of doing those at the same time. The radiation, yes, she would still receive radiation today.
Although it might be delivered in a shorter course, rather than...
We're going to get to that issue with the next case,
but
I think.
If we want to back up 30 years, she would have needed a mastectomy, so...
And if we want to back up 50 years, she would have had a radical mastectomy. Or 40 years, I don't know. When was the last radical mastectomy done?
Let's go with 40.
Let's go with 40, okay. Okay, second case. Ann C. is a 57-year-old teacher. She presents with a small lump in her right breast. A core biopsy reveals an invasive ductal cancer, which is grade 2, estrogen and progesterone receptor positive, and this time HER2 negative. A lumpectomy and sentinel biopsy are performed. The tumor is 2.4 centimeters, grade 2, it is estrogen and progesterone receptor positive, and that would be considered strongly estrogen and progesterone receptor positive. One of the 3 lymph nodes that's removed in the sentinel biopsy reveals a 0.3 centimeter area of invasive cancer. So she has one lymph node that is found to have cancer. And this is back in 2000. She has a completion axillary dissection. 22 lymph nodes are removed. And no tumor is identified. She then receives 4 cycles of AC and 4 cycles of paclitaxel. So this is, again, roughly 6 months of chemotherapy. And she receives 6 weeks of radiation. And this is someone who I think in almost all ways, both from a medical oncology standpoint, a radiation oncology standpoint, and we'll pretend to be radiation oncologists up here, and a surgical standpoint, would be managed differently today, and maybe we can touch on that. So Terry, if you could be both the surgeon and radiation oncologist, if you could touch on the approach we would take today to somebody who had one lymph node found at the time of a sentinel biopsy and then how her radiation would be done.
So if we fast forward now, we went from axillary lymph node dissection for everybody to learn the status of the nodes, to sentinel node biopsy to learn the status of the nodes. But in 2000, we would send the sentinel nodes to be looked at while the patient was in the operating room, and the pathologist would call us back, and if he saw any amount of cancer, no matter how big or small, we would go ahead with the completion axillary node dissection like Dr. Weiner described. About close to 5 years ago now, there was a study presented that really changed our management substantially. And that study demonstrated that if you took women with tumors of the size that this patient had, around 2 centimeters, so women with small tumors, and who were having lumpectomy and radiation therapy, who were keeping their breast, if you took them to the operating room and you found that they had cancer in 1 or 2 sentinel nodes, we learned from this study that whether you did additional surgery or whether you didn't do additional surgery, that it did not impact their long-term outcomes. Both groups were still doing extremely well at 5 years, and less than 1% of women were coming back with cancer under their arm, again, regardless of whether you took more lymph nodes out or whether you did not. And so that really, again, revolutionized the way that we care for women and the way we think about how much surgery we need to do under the arm. So in 2000, she got an axillary dissection, but all the other lymph nodes that were removed were completely normal. So that axillary dissection didn't help her. Today, we wouldn't even send the lymph nodes to be looked at in the operating room because we don't want to know if there's just a little bit in one node. We want to know the whole spectrum of what's there. So we do our lumpectomy, do our sentinel node, we wait for the final pathology report to come back, and if women have cancer in 1 or 2 lymph nodes, we do not return them to the operating room for more lymph node surgery. They don't need it, they don't benefit from it. If women have cancer in 3 or more lymph nodes, then those women have a higher volume of disease, and we do still return those women to the operating room for axillary node dissection. And again, when I was at Sloan Kettering, we applied this new algorithm to our patients, to everybody walking in the door who met the criteria, had small tumors and were having lumpectomies and radiation. When we applied this rule, again, we were able to save 84% of women from needing that completion axillary node dissection. So most women don't have breast cancer in 3 or more lymph nodes. They might have it in 1 or 2, but most women don't have it in 3 or more. And so again, sparing a significant proportion of women the more extensive axillary lymph node surgery. Secondly, what Dr. Weiner referred to with the radiation therapy. So for a long time, it was very easy to be the surgeon talking to the patient about radiation because I knew exactly what they were gonna get. Everybody got 5 weeks of radiation followed by a 1 week boost, 6 weeks of treatment. There was no variation. That was the easy answer to the question. And again, a couple of years ago, we started to see more and more data be presented and published demonstrating that you could actually shorten that radiation course and deliver it in 3 weeks, sometimes 4 weeks, but deliver it in 3 weeks with the same biological effect. So we're not shortchanging anybody, but they just have the techniques for delivering the doses. You still get the same cumulative dose, but in a smaller period of time. And again, there was no detriment on long-term outcomes. We're not seeing women coming back with recurrences in the breast because of the shorter radiation treatment course. And so just to clarify, when a woman is making a decision about her breast cancer surgical options, we know that lumpectomy plus radiation is equivalent to mastectomy in terms of survival from breast cancer. One is not better than the other. You don't need a big surgery to live longer. You can live longer with the smaller surgery, but the radiation still, we believe today, is a critical part of that. So lumpectomy and radiation is a package deal for the majority of women with breast cancer. There are some women at the extremes of age where we're again trying to dial back on that radiation part, but for the majority of women, lumpectomy plus radiation equals mastectomy in terms of survival. Again, bigger is not better. Even if you have a big, ugly tumor, it doesn't mean you necessarily need a mastectomy. It means you need more medications. But less surgery is okay. And again, less surgery, less side effects, less morbidity from our treatments.
Our job eventually is to get out of people's lives, not to have them see us all the time. A successful outcome is when somebody gets their treatment, it doesn't interfere with their life while they're getting it, and then they can forget that they knew us, except once or twice a year. All right, so Craig, This patient, who really was diagnosed more recently, but I said was diagnosed back a number of years ago, would have received that chemotherapy because she had node-positive breast cancer, and that was the treatment regimen we gave to most women with node-positive breast cancer, which was Adriamycin and Cytoxin, followed by paclitaxel. What would happen today?
So this is a situation in which she still may get chemotherapy, but we can make a more informed decision. I think what we knew then and what we know now is that a significant percentage of these women actually don't require chemotherapy, but in, this was 2000?
2000.
In 2000, we couldn't distinguish which ones did and which ones didn't. And now I would actually order a test called the Oncotype DX test that looks at specific cancer genes and their expression. That is, are those genes turned on or turned off? And in the pattern of how they are turned on or turned off, that gives us a genetic signature that can inform whether this patient would benefit from adding chemotherapy to her treatment or not. So I would send this woman's tumor for Oncotype testing,
the
which
result,
I assume you did.
The result was nine.
Nine. So the way that Oncotype works is it, based upon that genetic signature, categorizes a woman's risk, gives a recurrence score. And that recurrence score is categorized as either a low recurrence score, an intermediate recurrence score, or a high recurrence score. A high recurrence score means that there is significant benefit from the addition of chemotherapy to hormonal therapy. So this woman had hormone receptor positive disease. There's no question that that would be a part of the recommendation for her ongoing treatment. High recurrence score, significant benefit from chemotherapy. Low recurrence score, no additional benefit from chemotherapy. So it identifies about 50% or so of women who actually don't need chemotherapy. So it helps to spare them that recurrence, spare them that chemotherapy. A recurrence score of 9 is a very low recurrence score. And so this is a woman who in 2000 would have been treated with 6 months of chemotherapy with significant toxicity and risks, who today would not receive chemotherapy and would receive hormonal therapy and her radiation.
And so she goes on hormonal therapy, and you're worried that she might not take it because she has side effects. Tell us what we know about people taking their medication, and tell us about side effects and how we can manage them and why it's so important.
I mean, it is critical that women take their hormonal therapy when they have enough risk to warrant it. And our job is to help support women to make a good decision about that, but to do it in a way that they can tolerate it. I liken it a little bit, the whole Oncotype doing less rather than more is to it using a screwdriver rather than a sledgehammer. We used to hit all of our cancers with sledgehammers because that's kind of all we had along with the screwdriver. But when we learn that a cancer is very hormone sensitive, hormones are the best bang for the buck and chemo really adds little to nothing, but you gotta be able to take the hormones. And as many people in this audience probably know, it's not a cakewalk always to be taking the hormonal therapies because they can cause side effects, mostly side effects that are not high risk, as in cause a serious medical problem, although there are rare risks of serious medical problems, but more so quality of life side effects that can, after a long time, cause problems, because if you're not sleeping well from hot flashes, you can be pretty miserable and that can be a hard way to live. And there are many other things that can be associated with, or things like sexual dysfunction, among others. And so I think our big job is helping women to understand their potential risks, not to be afraid of the side effects, but to manage them and work with them very carefully to say, okay, this one is tolerable for you if you take this medicine or if you exercise and avoid triggers for hot flashes. This one maybe is intolerable for you, so let's switch to something else. So, you know, I liken it a little bit to a decision to take a pill if you're on a hormonal therapy is a decision you have to make every day. And that can be hard, right? We know that some women don't take their pills as directed, even though we think they are. It, you know, I always say to my patients, let's be you know, open and honest. I'm never going to judge you, but I need to know so I can help understand, you know, what your risks are and help you to make the best decision and or find another strategy for you. But I think we have to help to optimize that, support women, get them the best information possible, both with regard to the pros and cons of that decision, as well as how they can be supported, what medicines might help, what strategies might help to get them through and get them treated well.
And the benefits here of hormonal therapy are pretty substantial.
Yeah, they're generally huge for invasive breast cancer, but sometimes people are low risk and will peel off the hormones after a struggle.
But in this woman?
With this woman, it's very worth it, yeah.
And all right. It's also important to remember the primary goal of that hormonal therapy is to protect the woman from breast cancer showing up somewhere else in her body. That's the primary goal. But the extra benefit that women get from taking hormonal therapy is that it reduces the risk that they will develop a new cancer in their healthy breast. And it reduces that risk substantially, so that if this woman diagnosed with breast cancer today, she wants to know, she's terrified, she wants both breasts off today, okay? But you have to really counsel women, educate them that her other breast is not her enemy. The likelihood of her getting a breast cancer in the other breast over the next 10 years, if she takes that hormonal therapy, is about 3%, okay? 3%. So the benefits of the hormonal therapy are substantial in more than one way, and so we do have to find ways to help women stay on them and to take it.
All right. Well, thanks. I want to thank our great panel, and appreciate it.